Three current and former Rensselaer County employees handed themselves over to federal authorities today, accused of conspiring to commit voter fraud.
Those three defendants, Rich Crist, Jim Gordon, and Leslie Wallace, well, they looked exactly as you'd expect them to on a working Thursday afternoon. Crisp suits and shiny shoes. The only difference, though, the unusual accessory of handcuffs. We watched federal authorities remove those cuffs in court today in order for proceedings to begin. Judge Andrew Baxter read out the charges against the defendants, all three accused of conspiracy to violate constitutional rights, which carries a maximum 10 years behind bars. Gordon alone faces an additional charge of witness tampering, a potential 20-year sentence, and Wallace, an additional false statement charge, which could earn her an extra 5 years. It all stems from a federal investigation that alleges during the 2021 election, voters' names and birth dates were used to fraudulently apply for absentee ballots. While the state prosecutor and the defense attorneys agreed to release all three on their own recognizance, there was some back and forth over whether or not these defendants would receive a copy of the witness list. Assistant U.S. Attorney Michael Barnett arguing this case indicates a pattern of coercion, even intimidation, and many of the witnesses still work with Crist as the county's director of operations and Gordon as the director of central services. The judge ultimately ordered the defense would get their list, but it may not include all the witnesses, and ordered strict guidelines for how and when they can be contacted for work purposes.
Today, instead of observing the 75th anniversary of Israel, the UN is observing the anniversary of the Nakba, or catastrophe. The Nakba is what Palestinians say is their forcible eviction from the land of Palestine during Israel's War of Independence in 1948. Israeli ambassador to the UN Gilad Erdan blasted the UN, which is the source of many anti-Israel resolutions.
Instead of commemorating the real Nakba, the expulsion of almost a million Jews from Arab countries following the establishment of Israel, this biased organization is distorting its own history. I'm working to ensure that member states understand that attending this despicable event means destroying any chance of peace by adopting the Palestinian narrative calling the establishment of the State of Israel a disaster, while ignoring Palestinian hate, incitement, terror, and refusal to accept the legitimacy of a Jewish state.
My name is Ariel Del Turco, and I'm the director of the Center for Religious Liberty at Family Research Council. Our organization desires all people to have the freedom to exercise their faith. This freedom is significantly undermined whenever houses of worship are the targets of violent or destructive acts. It would be appropriate at this time to note that the FACE Act specifically includes protections for places of religious worship. It protects the faithful exercising their right of religious freedom in these places, while also protecting such places from efforts to damage or destroy their property. In December 2022, FRC released a report analyzing publicly documented acts of hostility against churches over the past 5 years. We identified 420 incidents that occurred in 45 states and Washington, D.C. between January 2018 and September 2022. We noted a recognizable increase in frequency over the course of that reporting period. These acts include vandalism, arson, bomb threats, gun-related incidents, and interruption of worship services. All of these are punishable under the FACE Act. FRC updated our report in April and found an additional 54 incidents in the final months of 2022 and 69 in the first quarter of 2023. If the trend continues, this year will be on track to have the highest number of church attacks over the last 6 years. All told, FRC has observed 565 attacks against churches from January 2018 to April 2023. I would now like to highlight a few examples for you. In February 2023, vandals broke into the Delabrook Presbyterian Church in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. They sprayed a fire extinguisher all over the church and into the ventilation system, causing $40,000 in damage. One church staff member told a local news station, "I keep wondering why. It shows a great deal of anger. Are they angry at us? Were they angry at churches? Were they angry at God?" In these attacks, many churches are defaced with obscene or hateful messages. In October 2021, vandals spray-painted anti-Catholic messages on the front of Denver's Cathedral Basilica of the Immaculate Conception, including the words, "Satan lives here." In March and April of 2019, three historically black Baptist churches in or near Port Barre, Louisiana, were set on fire by the same individual within a 10-day span. Following the leak of the Supreme Court's Dobbs decision last May, at least 57 acts of hostility against churches were directly related to abortion. On June 25th, the day after the Dobbs announcement, St. Patrick Catholic Church in Philadelphia was spray-painted outside with the phrase, "Abort the Church." On June 26th, pro-abortion protesters interrupted Mass at St. Joseph Catholic Church in Chicago and began chanting slogans and distributing leaflets. At least one protester held up a sign that read, "The Catholic Church has blood on its hands." Not only Christian churches are subjected to such attacks, the Anti-Defamation League reported hundreds of anti-Semitic incidents against Jewish institutions in 2022, including synagogues and Jewish schools. The American Civil Liberties Union has tracked nearly 400 anti-mosque incidents since 2005. Violent attacks against places of worship are completely unacceptable, and it should concern those of all faiths and political persuasions. As long as the FACE Act is on the books, it should be used to go after perpetrators of attacks on places of worship. Anti-religious hostility has no place in our society or any country that wants to call itself a land of freedom. This issue deserves the full attention of the American public and the full weight of law enforcement. We appreciate the subcommittee's interest in learning about attacks on places of religious worship as it considers the effectiveness and application of the FACE Act. Thank you for your time and consideration.
One student, more than 170 college acceptance letters, and a record $9 million in scholarship offers from 130 of them. Meet Malik Barnes, a student at the International High School of New Orleans.
Dale College, what school is this? Hilbert College. Always been devoted to trying to get my schoolwork done and get good grades always, of course, like the average child.
At just 16, Dennis Barnes is anything but the average child. He's just a few weeks away from graduating from International High School, and he's got a big decision to make. What college will he attend?
It's lovely to witness a young man who works hard while remaining humble and acknowledging God as the source of his success.
This star scholar has a 4.98 GPA, speaks fluent Espanol, and is on the track and basketball teams at school. So how does he do it all? Here he is with the answer to that question. So Malik, welcome, and how do you do it? I mean, are you good at time management?
Yes, ma'am, definitely. Good evening. How you doing?
I'm doing okay.
That's
so what's
good.
Your secret? Are you Superman?
No, ma'am, I'm far from it. I give all glory and honor to God, definitely. I thank my parents that are always supporting me and encouraging me. And definitely Miss Denise James, that's my school counselor at International High School. She has done a good job at working with me. She's helping me out so much. Definitely, like you said, time management is a big factor in everything. I kind of try to get everything done in an orderly schedule while maintaining school, extracurriculars, doing my applications. So definitely, it is something that I have to be able to do.
So why do you think you excel, Malik, in academics? I mean, is it your studying habits? Do things come easy to you? Do you work hard? What is it?
I think that those are all things that plays factors in my success. But one thing that I do definitely know for a fact is that I know I have dreams and aspirations that are long term, that's beyond right now in the next 10, 20 years. And those are all things that I want to accomplish, those dreams that I said. And I believe that right now is stepping stones to get where I want to be. So it's definitely a drive, a motivation to kind of push me to do what I have to do now so that whenever I graduate college and move on in life, I could be where I want to be.
We commend Dennis's parents for guiding and molding him into the man that Dennis has become. Indeed, he is a son who makes his parents glad, as Proverbs says. A wise son heareth his father's instruction, but a scorner heareth not rebuke. A wise son maketh a glad father, but a foolish man despiseth his mother. Proverbs 13 verse 1 and 15 verse 20. Dennis Malik Barnes holds the U.S. record for the number of college offers and scholarships. At 16, he has already earned 27 college credits. In this day and age, when social media distracts students and severely impairs their academic performance, it is impressive that Dennis was able to minimize distractions, resulting in this remarkable accomplishment.
You've earned 27 college credits. How did you do that?
I am dual enrolled at Sunday University of New Orleans, and I've been able to take those courses since I've been at International High School. I've taken the majority of my core classes, the majority of classes I would have to take as a freshman, so my math, my science, social studies, English, and along with some electives, of course, I've taken intro to criminal justice. I'm currently doing evidence, so I have been able to rack up those credits, and I'm hoping that they can help me down the line.
I am a little sad that he's going away so far, because I'm gonna miss my baby now.
This great news is what's lacking in the vast majority of schools in America. Most mainstream media, government, and schools have conspired with Satan to erase every trace of God and Judeo-Christian values from our society. Sadly, the more Americans reject God and godly values while embracing Satanism and self-worship, the more we see deterioration in our homes, schools, government, and society. In this video, we showed you what America has become since prayer and the reading of scriptures, notably the Ten Commandments, were banned from schools. One of the notable adverse effects of rejecting God was a sharp decline in school academic performance.
Look at this chart, our educational achievement. Our SAT total scores have dropped from 980 in 1963-62 when the Bible was removed to 910. Look at that downward spiral since the Bible and prayer have been taken out.
We are losing somewhere between 70 and 88% of our children by the end of their freshman year in college. That's the children of evangelicals. Somewhere between 70 and 88% of them have nothing to do with spiritual things by the end of their freshman year in college. Luke chapter 6 and verse 40. A pupil is not above his teacher, but everyone, after he has been fully trained, will be like his teacher. This is the New Testament version of Proverbs 22:6. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child the way he should go. When he is old, he will not depart from it. The New Testament version of that is right here in front of you. Luke chapter 6 and verse 40. A pupil is not above his teacher, but everyone, after he has been fully trained, will be like his teacher. It's simple. It makes sense. Whoever's your teacher is your discipler. You cannot separate education and discipleship. Whoever is educating our children is discipling our children, which means whoever educates the majority of children is discipling the majority of children. And if the pupil is not above his teacher, and if everyone will ultimately be like his teacher, you see the power of education.
But we have to talk about Mayor Eric Adams. He's no longer a Biden surrogate after directly criticizing the president, of course, on the migrant crisis. Listen.
Where the heck is the president of the United States?
That is a good question. This should not be happening to New York City, Chicago, Los Angeles, and the other big northern cities. And really, it should not be happening to El Paso or Brownsville, Texas. Good. No city should be carrying this burden. This is a national problem, and it needs a national solution.
I mean, Joey's right. Nobody should have to deal with this. But how bad of a blow is this to the Biden reelection campaign that a mayor of one of the most, if not the most liberal city in the United States is like, I'm not doing this.
We understand Chinese donors with ties to Hunter Biden's business deals and the Communist Party gave at least $105 million, 105, to the University of Pennsylvania between 2018 and 2022. That's the university housing president Biden's think tank, the Penn Biden Center. That amount is nearly double what was previously known, Hugo. And we know that it was Secretary of State Anthony Blinken who was running the Penn Biden Center. He got a big job. Now he's Secretary of State. Your thoughts on all of these connections to the Biden family?
Yeah, well, what has been revealed, and we wrote about this in the Washington Examiner, is yet another network of money flows linking the Chinese Communist Party and the Chinese government with the Biden family. It's easy to get to, it's easy to forget the wood for the trees. I mean, there are some, it's good that the details are being nailed down. And for example, the CEO of a Chinese merchant bank, which invested or gave $5.5 million to the University of Pennsylvania, was also sitting on a board that advised the Chinese government and the CCP, the Communist Party, and also happened to go to the White House, or actually maybe not to the White House, but met with President Biden when he was vice president. There was another company Chinese investment company, which it was a shareholder in a mining company, and that mining company happened to get some good rights in the Congo with the help of a company set up by Hunter Biden. Those are the details, but the overarching thing that one needs to remember about these sort of networks is the whole idea is to obscure the connections. One can get lost in all the corporate names, but we know that the Biden family received $10 million or more, and it was distributed through shell companies to people, including, for example, Biden's grandchildren, who clearly were not doing any work for this. This is the way influence peddling works.
Yeah, and we know that from Hillary Clinton as well, by the way. This feels like Russia hoax 2.0 in terms of the FBI ignoring all of this. The White House is still refusing to comment on the Durham report. And of course, that confirmed everything that we reported on this program from the early days of this story back in 2018, that Trump-Russia collusion story was made up by Trump's opponents, the Hillary Clinton campaign, and Democrats. We are with your colleague today, Kaylee McGee-White. Kaylee, jump in here.
Yeah, Hugo, it seems that the media is also complicit in not just the Russiagate hoax, but also you wrote earlier this week about how the media is completely disinterested in covering the Hunter Biden laptop story and even the connections to Joe Biden. What is the media's role in this, and why is it so significant that so many outlets are suppressing the truth on these matters?
Well, Kaylee, the truth is, and everybody has recognized this for a long time now, is that the bulk of the media, favor the Democrats. They don't want to report on. They've abandoned the role of reporting, without fear or favor, and when it comes to their own side. They want the Democrats to win. They don't want to make a lot of noise about anything where the Democrats are shown up. I mean, I think one of the things about the Durham report, which is absolutely the central irony here, which is confirms what we knew before, but nevertheless confirms it in an official way, is that the very people who make the most noise about the possibility of Russian interference in the 2016 election and Russian disinformation are the ones who relied on Russian disinformation in the Steele report to hack the American political system and disrupt an entire presidency. That is something which even now, people on the left, the people who want the Democrats to win, are trying to cover up. They're continuing to say, even after the Durham report, nothing to see here, nothing to see here, let's move on. There's lots to see here. It's now officially established, and it is a huge scandal.
For almost a decade, the security state, the FBI, and later, the Central Intelligence Agency, essentially served as a disinformation workshop for Hillary Clinton and the Democratic National Committee. It's undeniable, with the release of John Durham's report, that the FBI attempted to swing a presidential election in the United States of America. Election interference. John Durham's long-awaited report has been released, and the revelations are absolutely stunning. Do not listen to the talking point of the mainstream media. Much as we heard when it came to the pandemic of the unvaccinated or a threat to democracy, the talking point has gone out. The verbal tics have been crystallized. The mainstream media is uttering the phrase nothing burger. They're saying that Durham's report amounts to nothing. As you can always expect, when there's a talking point that has been issued, the opposite is true. The Durham report is, when it comes to a revelation of the truth, a bombshell. What it shows is a coordinated attempt within the FBI that laid the predicate later for the CIA to attempt to install Hillary Clinton and then later Joe Biden as the president of the United States. Perkins Coie attorney Michael Sussman decides he needs to create something against Donald Trump. Perkins Coie has another client. It's a data research fund connected to some colleges here in the United States. A guy named Jaffe runs it. And this is revealed in the Durham report. They go to this data firm and say, hey, can you backtrack some data and create a narrative that there's a connection between Donald Trump and Russia? That's it. You know what they say? There's lies, damn lies, and statistics. Wait till you get into internet data. And so what they do is they find this internet data and they create a narrative from it. There's this bank called Alpha Bank that serves as a back channel between the Trump campaign and Russia. Next thing you know, Perkins Coie shops this idea to everyone under the sun. the New York Times, MSNBC, and they don't run with it yet because they're like, this doesn't completely make sense. And then Michael Sussman, attorney for Hillary Clinton, goes to James Baker at the FBI. He does not tell Baker, I'm working for Hillary Clinton. In fact, he denies that he's working for a candidate. And he says, check out this stuff. I found this back channel. I think you should know. And the FBI doesn't really bite. And he says, well, you should know, the media is looking at this. You don't want to let them get ahead of you. He says, what media? Sussman says, the New York Times. What does the FBI do? What does Baker do? They call the New York Times and say, don't run that. We need to look into this. And then giving the idea that it's under investigation. New York Times runs it, says it's under investigation, which it wasn't before the idea that New York Times was going to run it. MSNBC runs it. Now you got pundits and Maddows all over the place going, look at these confusing connections. I was working at ESPN running the Will Cain show on ESPN Radio, and I'd look up the TV and go, what the hell is going on? I can't understand any of this, because the confusion was the point. And Maddow had a crazy ratings by turning it, the confusion, into a story. But it again was the snake eating its tail. Clinton and her firm creating a story through another data firm, feeding it to the media, which they also pitched it to the FBI, which together decided it's a story. And the minute you can say, hey, something's under investigation, it has the patina of credibility. Oh, it's under investigation. Trump must have been connected to Russia. Must have peed on some hooker. And yet, there's nothing. There's no evidence. There's no corroboration. There's no secondary source. There's nothing. Why? That's not how the FBI should, or in most cases, does operate. But the answer to why is that James Comey, head of the FBI, and Peter Strzok, and half a dozen to a dozen others, saw Donald Trump as Hitler. And so they were willing to set aside standards and practices. But not just that. Rest on fake evidence. The story isn't that there was no actual evidence. The story is they created fake evidence. A hoax. And attempted to swing an American election for president. That's your state security services. Against the will of the people.